That's a saying in the Sangha, in the Buddhist Sangha, that lay life, having a job and a boss and a family and obligations and responsibilities, is a dusty road. It collects mental defilements all by itself. Greed, hate, worries, speculations, conflicts, desires, addictions, economic responsibilities, bank loans, you name it. It's manifold, but the noble life is out in the open. Here the defilements evaporate, and that's true. That's true. They have a chance to evaporate because of circumstances. Being out in the open is very good for evaporation of mental defilements. Among those, I get a lot of letters these times about people who are addicted to pornography. And for the males, it can be so grave that actually, because they get used to seeing more and more colorful setups, so they fail to be able to have a normal sexual relationships with a woman, because basically they are not excited, sexually aroused by normal women. They have to look like this superwoman, silicone woman in the porn movies. And I guess the same goes the other way around for females looking at porn. This springs from not seeing the body as a full frame, which is the first foundations of awareness. Like seeing this body not as beautiful, not as me, not as mine, not as myself, not as what I am, not as what I'm made out of. Just as a foreign frame that is fed by food every day and has to be nursed, but is otherwise very fragile. And secondly, which is bound to vanish, because all bodies will die after a prolonged battle, with very frustrating battle, because it's a losing battle always, with aging, sickness and death. First off, it's of course that you look yourself in the mirror, and then whatever youthful beauty there was, this is lost. So vanity there has a serious kick in the bum. Then of course lose the ability to see, to hear, to think, to be exact, losing intelligence, losing ability to remember, losing ability to learn thereby. It's all functions of this bodily decay, and here under brain decay. So it's bad business to have a body. Nevertheless, because the brain contains what we call mirror neurons, then when we see somebody else having sex, or somebody else eat food or drink wine or whatever, being very famous, then whatever pleasure we know from experience that they must feel in that situation, this we feel a faint echo of. Evolutionary biologists, they mean that we have these mirror neurons because it causes social coherence in a group. From human flocks to anthills to flocks of birds. So they survive better if they feel more or less the same. However, when you suddenly have an internet and photographic equipment and so on, then you can record sound and color and forms in movement of this flesh scenes. Flesh on flesh. human bacon acting up with their genitals. And because this one has done this oneself, then this Arus wants memories about it and gives a faint kick of pleasure, and usually is associated with masturbation. And because it can be addictive, and because there's tons of it, because it's very, very good business, the porn industry is a $1 billion industry, and it almost exceeds the conventional industry. Like also gaming, computer gaming, is coming up and taking a serious bite of the entertainment funds, which is enormous spent in the world today. So much for the physiology and the autonomy and the social conditioning. That's why the pressure is there. But if one looks at one's own body as a kind of like a sausage, an ugly sausage, or a frame, or a bag filled with snot and excrement and something disgusting, repulsive, and one do that for a prolonged period of time, then the effect is, first of all, deathlessness. This is very, very liberating, because if you are not afraid of death, then you are not afraid of anything whatsoever. You're fearless. And this fearlessness, this causes a serious lift in mind, because mind goes kind of like free around. Doesn't fear anything from the front, from the back, from the sides, from anywhere. They're fearless from all four sides. It's an epithet of the Arahants, the awakened beings. So, because we have been falling in love with our own body for a long, long, long time, also when we were insects are also in love with their own body. And deers and devas in particular, everybody falls in love with this form when it's young and capable. Because of reproduction, then they also fall in love with whoever can participate in this reproductive cycle, also called sex. And so you have the whole gamut running. However, if one has habitually looked, I'd start training with the skeleton, for example. To the extent I just keep contemplating the skeleton, and I'm very good at that, because actually I owned a skeleton, besides the skeleton that is inside this bag of bones. Then I had, you get that as a medical student in Copenhagen, then you have a small wooden box where there's a whole collection of all the bones. Basically a complete skeleton. So you can look at all the structures. In the old days, it was skeleton fished up from the Ganges River. I think my skeleton was from Ukraine or another Eastern European country where you could buy these skeletons very cheap in the 50s and 60s. High quality also. Bleached, cooked, bleached, dried. Nevertheless, so I contemplated this skeleton intensively for a number of years, 3 or 4 years, I think, until I had kind of like breakthrough. How was the breakthrough characterized? It was characterized in this way, that if I didn't kind of pay attention and just went around in my own thoughts, then when I saw people on a bridge, even though they were having clothing on, then I will not regard it as people. I will, from my inner x-ray imaginary vision thing, see a bunch of skeletons and not a bunch of people passing out of, in and out of buses and trains and so on. Similarly, when I said meditating, then I would see my own body meditating as if from outside. But then I didn't see my body and my clothes, what I was dressed up like at that particular moment. I see a skeleton, sitting skeleton. And one day it so happened that when I saw this skeleton sitting on the floor, I was employed in London at that time, so it was a small room in London I sat meditating in the evening. Then suddenly, and I was very aware that this was my own skeleton sitting there meditating. Suddenly the skull fell off, plunk, and landed down in the lap of this sitting cross-legged skeleton, sitting in meditation pose. And I found that hysterically funny, so I had to laugh loudly. And even today I think it's funny. So this is kind of like a sign of liberation, that if you see your own death, if you see your own skeleton, then you think it's funny. And this is because of this release, that mind has been released from this addiction to own form. And concurrent with that, addictions to whatever one has as a sexual object, to their bodily form. Basically, of course, it is only form and color. It is only solidity, fluidity, heat and motion. There's no need to flip out of that and start burning out dollars on internet memberships of various porn clubs. There's no need. But nevertheless, because it's connected with this momentary pleasure, then it causes addiction, which later down the road causes long-term sorrow and frustration. Because one clearly experiences that one is not able to say no. In this addiction, one cannot say no. One is not a free being. Because if there is an ability to watch this porn and one is alone, then one will choose this short-term lane, jumping over the low fence of watching porn and then get some pleasure by masturbation. However, the sorrow is significant on the long run, because one, of course, loses the ability to have a normal sexual relationship to others, and thereby to form families, and thereby to connect to the world in a conventional way. Again, it is skeleton meditation or corpse meditation, intensive for a number of years, that cause this, that break this addiction, little by little. Then there will be relapses and so on, but if one continues the training, then it pays off. So one just has to stick to it and press hard. And one has to consider it like this, that one has to unlearn a pattern that has been reinforced over many, many lives and many, many times in each life. And to unlearn such a behavioral pattern, which is very deeply ingrown, very deeply embedded in mind, then one has to press hard for a long time. But even halfway down the road, one will feel considerable freedom. And it will be like a victory when one says, ah, no more of that. Monkey business. Monkey minding. Flesh adoring. Bacon bungee jumping. Huh? It is so primitive. It is so revolting, banal, vulgar, as it can be. So, keep up this asupa, disgust meditation, either on corpses or on skeletons. If you are homosexual, then it's best to use a skeleton which has no gender. Homosexual or bisexual, a skeleton that has no gender. If one is heterosexual, then one should use a corpse or a skeleton of one's own gender. So one should not use a corpse or a body from one's usual sexual object. Because even at when decayed, then if mind is pressed, then it can still find pleasure
in a dead body. At the Buddha's time, there was a man who digged up the bones of his wife and had sex with the bones. So it says something about how deeply ingrown this pattern is. But the Buddha said that he was not a grave offense because the body was fully decayed. But if there's been flesh on the body, then the monk will have been disrobed, basically, because of parajika offense, the worst offense you can do, have sex with another being, whether dead or alive. So, again, this is the first object of awareness, seeing the body as a full frame, whether the internal body, one's own body, or the external body's other's body. Thank you. Okay. So, the message was that discussed asubha meditation, asubha bhavana can disable porn addiction, sex addiction, food addiction, body addiction, beauty addiction, and the fear caused by clinging to the body. So it can furthermore induce fearlessness of death. So how can you do this disgust meditation? One sits down, silent place, with closed eyes, and then do body scanning. There are several variants. One can go from the top of the head down to the tip of the toe and back again, or vice versa, from the tip of the toe to the top of the head. The first is skeletal meditation, where one can start with the toes in the little toe, the bones in the little toe, the nails on the little toe, the toes in the forefoot, the heel bone, the two underleg bones, the knee skull, the femoral bone in the thigh, the hip bone, the five lumbar spine bones, and the 12 spine bones in the upper chest, the ribs, the sternum, the bone that sits in the middle of the chest, the clavicula, collarbones, the shoulder blade, the seven bones in the spine of the neck, the jawbone, the bones in the nose, the orbital bones, the hole in the ears, and the upper skull. And then down again. Whenever one starts a meditation, a scanning of the skeleton, one never skips over. One tries to complete scanning up, scanning down in every sitting. This is the easy one. Then one do the same now just with organs. One see all organs, not only the bones, but also tendons, fat tissue, skin, arteries, veins, nerves, muscles. Inside the belly, one sees the bladder, the kidneys, the liver, the gallbladder, the large intestines, large bowels, the small bowels, the excrement inside the bowels, the urine inside the bladder, the blood inside the blood vessels, the lymph, that is the juice of the flesh, you can say, that comes out the meat when you cook it on a pan. The lungs, the heart, the tongue, the air pipe, the eating pipe, esophagus, the skull, the tongue, the teeth, one by one, not too quickly, not too slowly. This scanning can induce the first jhana. It induces only the first jhana if one goes not too quickly. If one hurries up and is busy, one cannot get absorption. Get absorption will be like your visual imagination is sometimes suddenly inside the teeth or inside the bone. Or you see unusual level of details. As on macroscopic scale, as macroscopic scale, on all scales of size, you see from any angle. So any anatomical detail can appear suddenly. And when you get absorbed into that, interested into that, focused upon that, then absorption, jhana, first jhana occurs. Then just hang on there with the process. But if one goes too quickly, jumps from one visualization to the next, it doesn't occur. The meditation still have effect, but not so much. The temple, the forest monk temple, with natural orchids, and waterfalls, and frogs. Yabba-dabba-doo! And blood-sucking leeches. I love it. From the deep, deep of my heart. This wilderness. This naturalness. Just as it really is. However, just noticing, if one falls in love with nature, and I'm not alone on that one either, then this could be seen as a kind of a nature porn movie, huh? Because we are dwelling in this excessively beautiful nature. However, attachment to the colors and forms and smells and sounds inside this forest, it also has to be relinquished. But it's definitely a nice stepping stone from the porn addiction and advertisement stress of the city life. Definitely. Out here, peace of mind is easy to attain. Easy, easy, easy. Come on, friends. There are empty huts. There are roots of trees. Meditate, friends. Don't be lazy. Don't neglect. Work out your own mental release.
with enthusiasm, virya, and not heedlessness and careless complacency, which is the usual social convention of the city dweller. Ah, we can just eat some more soft ice and see a new movie, and then this sorrow goes away. Ah, yes, we come back tomorrow. What about it? Ah, didn't we take a soft ice and movie and blah 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 entertainment again? Is that freedom? Nope. Definitely not. Plenty of water. To the hydropower turbine. Oh, a lot of deer tracks here. Maybe I should put a camera up here.